Hey guys, in this week's episode, we are back. We are reviewing Army of the Dead, the new Netflix film from Zack Snyder. But before that, we're going to talk about Charlie Kaufman's Antkind and The Bad Batch. So join us.
Welcome to the Casual Cinecast, powered by Cinelinks. My name is Justin, and with me, as always, is a man who wants to command an army of the dead. I didn't have time to think of a funny quip. Mike, how you doing?
I don't know. I've got no response to that.
It's okay. It wasn't good enough.
Here I am. I'm Mike. Hi.
How you doing? It's been a minute.
Doing well. Yeah, it has been a minute since like the Oscars, but you know what? The hiatus has done us good, I think.
Yeah, I needed some time to recover from how boring and dreadful the Oscar ceremony was.
Yeah, I didn't even watch it, but man, I heard all about it, and it sounds like a mess.
I've been slowly picking myself back up ever since for the last month or so that we've been on hiatus.
it just really took the wind out of everyone, I think. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's good to be back.
It is.
All right. If this is your first time listening, normally we like to start off every episode in a section called News on the March, where we talk about film and TV news or the movies or TV that we have been watching. Then we move into our feature review. As I said at the top of the show, this week it's discussing Army of the Dead.
That's right. And here on the Casual Cinecast, every other week, or just about every other week, depending on how long we take month-long hiatuses, which isn't that often. but every other week or so, we like to put out a Casually Criterion episode. In these episodes, listeners choose a film from the Criterion Collection for us to review, and they vote in a poll that we put out on our Twitter account. So look forward to our next Criterion poll, which will be on our next Criterion episode, which will be Come and See, the war film. And also go back and check out our latest episode on David Fincher's The Game and lots of other Criterion films. I think we've done probably darn near 100 of them, maybe less.
Yeah, there's quite the back catalog now, so
yeah,
have at it.
That's right. And as I said, the poll that we do for the Criterion films is on our Twitter account. You can follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, also at Casual Cinecast. If you want to ask us any questions about the movies we're reviewing or send us a message about anything at all, you can send DMs to any of those social media accounts, or you can email us at casualcinemedia@gmail.com. And then last but not least, if you haven't done so already, you like the show, you want to help other people find it, go into iTunes or whatever platform you listen to podcasts on and give us a 5-star review and say some kind words about us, and we will be grateful.
Eternally so. Thank you in advance.
Eternally. And did you say eternally or internally?
Eternally.
Okay. That's what I thought.
But internally as well, I suppose.
Yeah. And externally, because
we'll why not
say thank you now.
Yeah. All right. And I think with that, it's time to go ahead and just get into the show.
Yeah, why not?
All right, news on the march. Here we go.
News on the march!
So, Justin, it's been a minute. What have you been up to? What do you got going on today on News on the March?
Well, I haven't been watching a ton. As I half joke, half truth said earlier, the Oscars kind of took a lot of wind out of my sails. And so lately I've found myself reading a ton. I've been reading a lot of Star Wars books and other like nonfiction books. But the thing that I finished, I think, since we did our last episode, that I wanted to follow up on, because when I started this book, I talked about it a little bit, but that was Charlie Kaufman's debut novel, Antkind. I finished it.
Yes. Yeah.
And I really loved it and thought it was super weird and dark and depressing and relatable and all kinds of surreal things. And
It sounds like watching a Charlie Kaufman movie.
Yeah, it really is the novel equivalent of that, I think. And he definitely does stuff with the form that you couldn't do in a movie. So I appreciate him taking advantage of that and being kind of meta about it in some ways. But I guess I just want to talk about it and just like recommend it. And I'm curious if any listeners out there have read this book. because I would love to hear your opinion, because I am the only person I know who has read this book and I have no one to talk about it with. And I think more people should read it, because I think it's really good. And I'll just a brief synopsis of what it's about. The main character is a film critic, and he's very kind of neurotic, and he's kind of like overly, like I guess you would say a caricature of like the modern day, like politically correct person, where he's like overly worried about, you know, his status as a white male and how his opinion on most things don't matter.
Yeah.
Even though he's a film critic and he's constantly, you know, overdoing it in terms of trying to give people the proper gender pronouns and convincing people that he's not racist because he's white and that sort of thing, which is pretty funny and entertaining. But the crux of this story is that he stumbles across this, like, I think something like 120-year-old man who's been shooting a stop motion film for 90 something years of his life. And he's never shown the film to anybody, and he shows it to the main character, and it's a 3-month long film. And it's the greatest thing that he's ever seen. He thinks it's amazing. So he decides that he's going to, you know, show it to the world, because the creator dies like right after he finishes watching it. And he's going to take it and show it to the world. But then he ends up loading it in his car, and the car catches fire and burns the whole film. So he's basically spends the rest of the book tormented and trying to remember this film, and parts of it he thinks he's going to recreate it from memory, and all sorts of stuff ensues from there. But it's kind of like you've seen the greatest film in the world, but and you want to honor this person's legacy, but you can't because you destroyed it. So it's very weird. That's just kind of like scratching the surface.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that does sound interesting. You know, every time like a director or someone starts to dive into like fiction novels, I always find that really fascinating.
Me too. Jodorowsky, I think, wrote a book not that long ago. He's got a book I've stumbled across but did not buy, and Hef writes books one time, and I need to get on that.
That would be quite interesting. I am also curious about the novelization, like an expanded version of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because apparently Quentin Tarantino wanted to make that a book before he decided to make it into a movie.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. You know, I mean, and Tarantino's scripts have a tendency to just go off like on wild tangents that end up not getting filmed. Like, do you remember the script a long time ago for Django Unchained?
Vaguely. I've seen the movie a couple times, and it's kind of overshadowed my memory of what was.
Well, there was a whole section about like Broomhilda, his wife's adventures, and like met this other guy that was like kind of like a man baby.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. And she had like, and she kind of manipulated him a little bit, but like before she ended up getting to Leonardo DiCaprio's place. So, anyways, I like the idea of a director. And their only limitation is their imagination.
Yeah, they're not bound by budget.
Yeah, and with Charlie Kaufman, it seems like that guy's imagination, I imagine, can go to some pretty dark and depressing places.
Yeah.
But also potentially hilarious ones, too.
Yeah.
And he does that with movies all the time, so I can only imagine just without like the constraint of budget and the medium itself, just going completely, you know, balls to the wall is crazy.
Yeah, that's what happens. And like, I can't even begin to go into any sort of crazy place that this film goes and have it make any sense without needing a bunch of explanation.
You mean book?
Oh, yeah, book. Yeah, sorry. Thank you. So used to talking about films with Kaufman. But yeah, it looks like there's a paperback out now, which is awesome, because I had to pay for full price for the hardcover because I was so curious. And I kind of hate doing that because hardcovers are super expensive.
Yeah, but they're classy.
Yeah, but they are. They're also a pain because they usually have like a slip cover on them, and that always slides around when you're trying to hold it and read it.
Yeah, you figured the slip cover technology on books would have improved over the years, but it doesn't seem like that's happening.
It's the same amount of annoying as it was renting from the library when I was in third grade or something.
Yeah.
But yeah, this book, there's a ton for film people, which is why I bring it up on this podcast and recommend it. Obviously, it's Charlie Kaufman, but there's a lot of in jokes and fun that he has with a bit of an alternate reality, if you will, where he talks about, you know, films that a director that we know, like, say, like Woody Allen or something that he's made, but he'll make up like fake film titles and fake films that he did that he talks about that sound kind of like they could be Woody Allen.
They could be a Woody Allen movie.
Yeah, they could be real, but they're not. Like, sometimes I had to stop and look up and say, like, was this movie real that he's talking about that, you know, John C. Reilly was in or whatever? And then also the critic hates Charlie Kaufman, like, in his films and his scripts. So,
oh, nice. Why? Are they pretentious? Is that why?
Yeah, he just thinks he's a talentless hack that doesn't have like original idea or something like that.
That's
which
funny.
Is funny. So you get to hear him sort of meta talk a lot of shit about himself, which is great.
All right. Yeah.
So yeah, anyways, that's my recommendation. And like I said, just been reading a lot of other books, nothing worth getting into here, and haven't watched a ton. So that's it for me in a way.
Yeah. And that was Antkind, right?
Yes. Charlie Kaufman's Antkind, like a, not like a uncle and aunt, but an insect aunt.
Yeah. All right. Cool.
Cool. But yeah, Mike, do you want to lead us into what else we have both been watching?
Yeah. You know, like you, I've been cooling it on new movies. I've been watching, rewatching a lot of like movies and stuff here lately, but I don't really want to get into any of those. Other than just to say, Kill Bill Volume 2 is still better than Kill Bill Volume 1.
I believe it. I'm with you.
But other than that, the only thing I've really been getting up to is watching The Bad Batch every week, which is like the new animated show on Disney Plus. Mm-hmm. That and Mass Effect have pretty much taken up my entire last couple weeks.
Yeah. Animated Star Wars show.
Yeah, animated Star Wars. Yes. The Bad Batch, of course, is like it's like a successor show to The Clone Wars, but it's also its own thing at the same time. And it also takes place before the other Star Wars cartoon that exists, Rebels. So it's like this weird in-between spot where Star Wars always finds room to just tell more stories, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it, from my understanding, fleshes out a lot of the time, you know, post Clone Wars cartoon and I guess before. Well, no, because it's kind of a post-Revenge of the Sith, isn't it?
Yeah, it's like Clone Wars Season 7 and Revenge of the Sith. Like, the last four episodes of the Clone Wars take place concurrently with Revenge of the Sith.
Mm.
So, like, there are actually, like, scenes in the last four episodes of the Clone Wars that are expansions of scenes in the movie. Like, where you'll see, like a conversation of, like, Yoda and Mace Windu and Obi-Wan Kenobi, like a hollow conversation where they're all, like, talking in different places. And then, like, the Clone Wars cartoon will take that same conversation where the movie ended. It'll keep going with that conversation. And then 2 seconds later, like, Ahsoka Tano walks up and joins in the conversation. So it kind of, like, makes it feel like it's the same story, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And The Bad Batch in episode one kind of starts similarly, right? It starts off kind of concurrently with Revenge of the Sith as well, where we see, like, Order 66 taking place, like, within, like, the first, like, 10 minutes of the episode.
Yeah. And what an episode.
And
episode.
It kind of grounds us to where we're at, you know?
Yeah, what an episode episode one was. Like, it was basically a movie. I think it was an
hour
and
20. Yeah, it actually felt pretty good, too. Like, I think it calls in and ties in with the Clone Wars and with Rebels, but not in a way to where, like, if you haven't seen those things, you need to.
Yes, because I have not seen them, and I do not feel lost. Granted, I've seen other Star Wars things, but...
Yeah, yeah. And it also, it gives us a pretty much a breakdown of, like, how free the clones are and aren't, right? Like, because I was always kind of unclear, unless you watched Clone Wars. But, you know, within 30 minutes of The Bad Batch, you kind of get the idea. You're like, oh, okay, there's a chip in the clones' heads. This is why they do what they do. The Bad Batch seems to be immune from their chips because of their mutations. Or are they? You know, that's the thing. Or are they?
Yeah, that's the big question. How long can they hold out?
Let's just go ahead and say right here, I guess, spoilers for episodes 1 through 4, right?
Sure. Yeah. We might talk about some stuff. Who knows?
Okay, cool. So, obviously one of them's still got the chip in it. And here's the thing, though. I don't know if you've noticed this. Have you noticed that, like, in every episode, Wrecker, the big one that's like a big child?
Yeah.
He keeps hitting his head.
I don't think I've noticed that specifically, but I've noticed that he's clumsy for sure.
Well, yeah, he's definitely clumsy. Like, you know, he's supposed to be like the comic relief and all that stuff. But, like, I think what's going to happen... I think they're foreshadowing. Like, I think he's going to hit his head once too many times, and I think his chip's going to become active.
Yeah, which is not good.
And then he'll be dangerous to be around, I imagine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not good, because him and Omega, the child, have a pretty good relationship. And if he turns bad, she could be very vulnerable.
Yeah, well, they're like peers, I think, sort of, you know? Like, he's the grown-up, technically, but not really mentally, right?
Right, yeah.
That's actually kind of better, because in the first episode, and when the Bad Batch appeared in the Clone Wars, I was thought, you know, Wrecker was sort of just, like, supposed to be, like, dumb and big, and that was, like, the extent of it. And he is that. But the added element of him being, like, a big child makes me hate him less, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I understand.
Instead of just being big and, like, me, dumb, you know?
Yeah, I get you. I think he's probably the character that I like the least in the show anyways. So
yeah, well, definitely.
I can imagine.
He's got the least dimension to him.
Yeah. Which...
But I think he's there for the kids, you know?
Yeah, and that's the thing that I have to remind myself sometimes when watching this, is that it is, you know, a kids or a family, as a sort of animated show. At least most of the time, it actually does go some surprisingly dark places in certain episodes so far.
Yeah, it has so far,
but
for sure.
There are times where I feel the kids show in it a little too hard. And I think that combined with the voice acting, and then I like the animation. I think it's okay, but it also reminds me of some like cheaper animation that I saw in like church as a kid, watching animated like church shows and stuff, and something about it just takes me back to those times, and it kind of feels a little cheeseball at
what,
times.
Like VeggieTales?
Kind of, it's not quite VeggieTales, but like there were other things that I couldn't even begin to tell you the name of that they showed us. But there were some, you know, this sort of simple 3D animation.
Well, I think, yeah, I mean, you're right to a degree. Like, it's not movie quality, right? Like, it's not Pixar.
No.
But I think you're selling it short. It's better than most animated, like, the Bad Batch is. Like, the first three seasons of the Clone Wars can be pretty rough.
Yeah, I'm not saying it's bad animation. There's just a quality of that plus the child-like quality of Wrecker and Omega and, like, their voice acting.
Yeah.
It just rings a little bell for me that reminds me of those days.
Fair enough.
It's not like I'm necessarily complaining, because I would rather watch this.
Yeah. I mean, it's a show that so far is not great, and I don't know if it ever will be great. But it's, I don't know, man. It's better than I expected it to be based on like the idea of a show about the Bad Batch.
Yeah.
Which is like... bunch of clones, because like I don't know, the clones were always kind of my least favorite part of the Clone Wars, because I couldn't keep them straight. I couldn't keep, you know, they all had like nicknames and unique haircuts and all that, and like slightly different armor, and I could remember maybe like three or four of them.
Yeah,
and the rest of them I would always forget who they were, what was going on with them. And the Bad Batch I don't have that trouble with, because they're all pretty unique looking.
Yeah, they are.
But like, I don't know. Like, before the show began, I was kind of worried. I was like, I don't know if the clones are, like, interesting enough. And I don't know if the Bad Batch is interesting enough to, like, merit a TV show. And I don't know how long they can keep this going. But so far, I'm interested way more than I thought I would be.
Yeah, I agree. And I think, too, it may not be a show that, if you don't like Star Wars, that would turn you around or something, or that you would enjoy without liking Star Wars. It's... something that I enjoy just because it fills in gaps and just, you know, adds more and paints in more color to like the whole galaxy or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, and it seems pretty planned out with like, for example, like The Mandalorian. It's even tied in with stuff like that. Like, not only is it a successor to The Clone Wars and a precursor to Rebels, and within the first 30 minutes, there's tie-ins to both of those things. But then also within the first episode... and certainly the second, third, and fourth, there have been tie-ins to The Mandalorian as well. You know, implementation of the chain code. This is like the Empire really starting to grow really fast, and how it goes from Republic to Empire, and what is that transition like? You know, like all of a sudden, they're like, hey, citizens, you know, you're in an Empire now, and guess what? Your money's no good anymore. You can get new money if you want, but also we're going to have to sign up for a chain code so we can track you. You know, like this is... the process in which all that started happening. And I think they're doing that in a way where it it, like you said, fills out the gaps in the universe in ways that I think are really fun and interesting.
Yeah.
If you're into that kind of, you know, lore and extended universe stuff, which I am.
Yeah. I mean, it's fun to kind of dive in and dig deep on those sort of things. And I think this is kind of proving to me, even though, you know, as we've kind of said, it's not an amazing show. It's not perfect by any means, but I'm really enjoying, between this and Mandalorian, my Star Wars content being serialized and short and week to week versus, you know, waiting 15 years for a new trilogy to come out and waiting years between those and like having these big expectations for them and having years to anticipate what's going to happen and kind of build what you think is going to happen in your mind and then maybe ultimately be disappointed. I feel like it's harder to
because I get what I mean. Can a 2-hour and 15-minute movie ever really like scratch an itch that you've been waiting years for? Like, sure it can, but more times than not, you're going to be left a little wanting, I think.
Yeah, I think that makes sense.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think Star Wars lends itself better to serialized content, and like you said, fleshing out the universe, supporting the movies, all this. You know, so far has been working out really well for them. And as long as they keep the canon continuity pretty strong, you know, let's put it this way. I think this show is more accessible for people who don't like the Clone Wars than like starting the Clone Wars. Like, I think like if you're on the fence about Star Wars cartoons or if you've never watched one, I think this is a good one to start with.
Yeah.
And then if you like it, go back and explore more. But I think that's easier than trying to recommend people go back and watch like an animated show that started in like 2008 with a budget that's like a fraction of what it is now.
Yeah. Fair enough.
Real quick, the only other thing I want to say about The Bad Batch is I thought Ming-Na Wen showing up as Fennec Shand in episode 4 was really cool.
Remind me which character that was?
The sniper from Mando season 1 and 2. That, remember, like she gets shot and then Boba Fett saves her and replaces her belly with a robotic belly.
Oh,
and then
yeah,
she works for Boba Fett because she's got a life debt to him now.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I don't
spoilers
think I made
for
that.
All of that. But anyway, she was the bounty hunter last episode.
Yeah. Okay.
That was going after Omega.
Yeah. Okay. I did not make that connection.
Yeah. It's like the same actress and she's wearing the same outfit.
I guess I just didn't remember her as well from Mandalorian. Like, it didn't stick in my head. But it's fun that I know that now.
You were distracted from all that Boba Fett going on.
Yeah, I was distracted by Omega's New Zealand accent every time she was on screen. So, because it's super New Zealand.
Yeah, it's super cute.
Yeah, it just sounds like a... Because I think Rhys Darby in Flight of the Conchords has like the most caricatured... New Zealand, maybe that's his real accent, but it's just such a caricature of the New Zealand accent that like, and this sounds really similar to me, just, you know, higher pitched and more childlike.
Yep, that makes sense. But yeah, that's all I've really got for Bad Batch.
Yeah, and I think that's all we really have for News on the March this week.
Yeah, so let's just go ahead and just get into our review for Army of the Dead.
Let's go.
Mr. Ward, how would you like to make $50 million on a warm summer's evening? On a train bound for nowhere, met up with a gambler. We were both too tired to sleep, so we took turns of staring out the window at the darkness. The boredom overtook us, and he began to speak. He said, son, I've made a life out of reading people's faces.
Think about it. Everything we did, all those people we saved.
The way they held their eyes.
Look what it got us.
You don't mind my saying.
Now what if?
I can see you're out of ace.
What if just once
for a taste of your whiskey,
we did something just for us?
You ready to play?
There's $200 million in the vault beneath the strip, with a 32-hour window to get it out. Find the safe. This should be a simple in and out.
It's not too late to go back.
If you go the...
Okay, so as always with our newer films, we will be doing a spoiler-free section up front. We will give our general thoughts on the film without being spoilery. And when we do decide to get into spoilers, we'll give you a warning. We'll play a bumper so that you have plenty of time to pause the podcast, go onto Netflix, watch Army of the Dead, and then come back and finish listening to the episode.
That's right. So, Army of the Dead was directed by Zack Snyder. It stars Dave Bautista, Ella Purnell, Ana de la Reguera? Oh my. The IMDb synopsis says, following a zombie outbreak in Las Vegas, a group of mercenaries take the ultimate gamble, venturing into the quarantine zone to pull off the greatest heist ever attempted. Sorry, I had to move the Skype window out of the way to read the rest of that synopsis, so there was a little bit of a delay.
It sounded great. Thank you. Would have known, except I did notice that you paused.
All right. So, who wants to get us started? Do you have any opening thoughts for Army of the Dead, sir?
No, sure. Yeah, I can get us started, and I'll start with saying that Zack Snyder's a director that I usually am pretty mixed on. Like, I'm kind of oftentimes in the middle of the road, unless you count his superhero series of films, which I'm, I guess, not middle of the road, whatever it would be that
you're off the road. You don't like them.
I'm lower on the road, lower than middle of the road.
You're to the left or right, whichever.
Yeah. I guess left if it's a scale of 1 to 10, because usually you would increase those. But anyways, I am not as big of a fan of those. But the thing for me about Zack Snyder is that I'm usually interested in what he's making, because I really, really like his Dawn of the Dead remake a lot. And I love Watchmen. I think it's great. And so I'm always interested in what he's doing, because I think that maybe any time now he's going to just pop out another really good to great film out of nowhere. And I think the thing about Army of the Dead for me that intrigued me was that it's obviously another of the dead movie. And I guess that is close enough to Dawn of the Dead that it gave me hope that it would be something, you know, as fun, maybe as revolutionary as Dawn of the Dead felt for like zombie films. At least for me, like I'm not an expert in zombie films, but Dawn of the Dead, one of the things I loved was it just felt fresh and the zombies were fast and it had an awesome mix of like humor and seriousness and violence that was like always engaging. And
Well, like, it was written by James Gunn, which is, I think, important to note.
That is important to note. And I don't think he wrote this one.
No, he did not.
and I guess maybe that's where the difference lies, because I am pretty middle of the road on this film, as I've been with Zack Snyder lately. I think that the film is 2.5 hours long, but also feels like it's missing about 45 minutes of stuff to really flesh out some things that happen and make some things happen that are things that do happen make more sense and make character journeys feel a little more satisfied and a little more earned. Because I feel like we have characters suddenly expressing feelings and emotions that I didn't really understand that they had until they start expressing them, and ideas that they have that kind of just come out of nowhere and I don't fully understand. And I between that and the film kind of has some weird tonal shifts to me, or maybe it's just like tonally at odds with itself sometimes, with how fun and funny it wants to be and then how serious and moving it wants to be at other times, and neither one is fully successful, I think, because sometimes I'm feeling the other one and it tries to switch tones back to something else. And I felt confused a lot watching this movie of what the film was trying to be. And it felt a bit assembled together in a way that didn't feel complete to me. Like, it felt like there were ideas that got cut or ideas that people loved even though they didn't work, so they stayed in there at the expense of maybe something else that got cut. And I don't know. I just find myself confused a lot. But why am I middle of the road versus just straight up disliking this film is because, you know, it's a pretty fun zombie movie. There's lots of good zombie kills. There's some interesting takes on zombies and the evolution of what the zombie can be that I find almost interesting. And just as a concept in general, like, it's pretty fun. There's a good ticking clock mm-hmm. element to this heist of that adds some really good suspense. There's, you know, a really diverse cast of characters that, you know, on the surface I find interesting and watchable, even if not fully fleshed out as much as I'd like them to be by the end.
Sure. Yeah.
So there's some entertainment there. I think it's certainly entertaining. And as usual, I enjoyed the opening credit sequence and the amount of story that we get out of it, and just the visuals of it were really fun. And I think that's a Zack Snyder staple that he still seems to have. So that's where I'll leave it, I think.
Yeah, you know, I'm pretty much exactly where you're at. I have a very similar relationship to Zack Snyder. I really liked Dawn of the Dead. Didn't so much care for 300, but I thought it was a visual treat, right? Well directed.
Yeah.
Here's what I pretty much think about Zack Snyder across the board. It's like, he's a good director. He's not a good writer.
Yeah.
If he's got a good script, he can direct a good movie.
Yeah. He's got a vision, for sure.
Yeah. He's got an eye for vision. He can work with special effects houses to where he can make CGI that doesn't look like what anyone else is doing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he is sharp when it comes to that stuff. Like, he's really good at filming to where you don't even know you're looking at something that's completely fake. You don't know where the CGI ends or where it begins. Everything looks like it's kind of CGI, and then also nothing.
Yeah.
He's really good about that.
I agree.
But like I said, I think he needs someone else to write his scripts for him. And I think Dawn of the Dead is a perfect example versus Army of the Dead, right? Like, Army of the Dead has a lot of good in it, I think. There's some cool scenes. I think Dave Bautista is great. I think he can carry a movie. He's got range. I really like Dave Bautista.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I like most of the cast. They're all strong here. I like the way this movie looks most of the time. I think the zombies look a little cheap, but that might be a budget thing.
I feel that way about some of them, which we can talk about those in spoilers probably.
Yeah. There's a main zombie that pops up a couple times where I wasn't a big fan of the look of her. And she's a very prominent zombie in the film that's like featured a lot in a lot of close-ups.
Yeah.
And I thought her makeup looked really kind of dumb.
I said the whole design of that character for me.
Yeah, basically. But I don't know. Like you said, the it's a fun heist movie. I wasn't looking for anything to reinvent the wheel here. I was just looking for a good, fun romp, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And this movie, I think if you turn your brain off, that this movie could be that for you. I begrudge no one and judge no one who had a great time with this movie.
Yeah.
I was a little bored myself, but I've also seen a lot of zombie films in my day. And I don't think this one brings enough new to the table to, I don't know, to justify its runtime. But then, like you said, also, it seems like a movie that could be better with a longer runtime that I just didn't want to sit there any longer. I will say, sidebar, this is the first film I watched back in a movie theater since The Invisible Man.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I went to the Angelica. It was nice. The experience alone of just being back in a movie theater was, I'm vaccinated, by the way. There was only like two other people in the movie theater. So it was nice. It was that experience alone kind of elevated this movie for me. You know, it made it feel like a bigger deal. It was nice. I really had fun. I can't wait to go back to the movies again to see something else, you know?
Yeah, no, it sounds great. I watched it on Netflix, so this experience was very similar.
Yeah, I didn't even realize this wasn't out on Netflix yet when I watched it. And I watched it like a week ago, or like a little over a week ago, I think. And then I think Army of the Dead hit like Friday. So I felt cool having already seen it when everyone else was just starting it.
Yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah. A little bit of superiority there, you know?
Mm-hmm. Always feel superior if you can. That's how I live my life.
If you can, it's great. It really does wonders. But yeah, all in all, I would say that the script is a mess. The characters are pretty shallow and one-dimensional. a lot of them make decisions that are frustrating and, although are relevant to make the plot go forward, don't make them any less frustrating to experience.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes you kind of just not like some of the characters that you might have otherwise liked because they make the classic dumb move in a zombie outbreak and they branch off from the group too much and just, you know, a bunch of cliches.
Yeah, I think that's where I felt most annoyed at the script. And there were definitely a few times I rolled my eyes when we got some, I don't know, it's like the greatest hits of zombie movies in some ways alongside a film that felt like it was at least attempting to be unique and could have been unique. You know, this Las Vegas apocalyptic version of it with a zombie outbreak and people are trying to go pull off a casino heist is like, that's a pretty interesting concept.
Yeah, I'm sold.
Yeah. And then just peppered throughout, there's so many moments I felt like I've seen in, if not, you know, other zombie movies and other movies in general. And I don't know, that's one of the things that bugged me.
Yeah, no, I am right there with you. I will say that one little bit of humor that actually landed for me pretty well in the year of our Lord 2021 is there's a newscast on TV where like the president of the United States is talking about like nuking Las Vegas on the 4th of July.
Yeah.
Because it would be awesome or cool, and it's actually kind of patriotic if you think about it.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
And that once upon a time may have been like an over the top line in a movie that I hated or cringed at.
Yeah.
But not anymore. Nope. It actually made me laugh.
Yeah, it's all too real. And
yeah, you know, the it's kind of patriotic if you think about it part of it all.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I did. I just kind of liked that whole element of the story of, well, I guess it's spoilery, so I can't really talk about that. But
well, you know what? I'm down to get into spoilers pretty soon. I think we've given general thoughts. Everything from here on out is just going to be me breaking down specifics of what I think, you know?
Yeah, there's not much to talk about other than cool zombie deaths and some of the actual choices characters make. And yeah, that sort of thing that is spoilery.
So let's just go ahead and rate the thing now and then get into spoilers. What do you say?
Yeah, absolutely. 1 out of 10, as always.
1 out of 10?
Yeah.
That's rough.
Or 1 out of 5 stars. That's what we normally do.
Oh, you're right. The scale. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I just do out of 5 stars, and then we do halves. I thought you meant you gave it a 1 out of 10.
Oh, no, sorry. Like, I was asking about the rating scale. It's been a while, so I wanted to make it. But I even said the wrong rating scale because, yeah, you're right. We do 1 out of 5.
I'll kick it off. I gave it 2.5 stars on Letterboxd.
Okay. Yeah. I would give it the exact same score.
Yeah. It was 3 for a minute when I left the theater.
Yeah.
But then I thought about some of the things I'm about to talk about, and then it dropped a 0.5 star.
Yeah. That's fair. That theater bump, that theater high, I can imagine bumping it up a 0.5 star totally.
Yeah, I mean, that's probably true. Okay, so it seems like both of us recommend it if you like zombie movies, but there are better zombie movies you could watch if you have not seen them.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, but if you like zombie movies, you've probably seen all the ones that are better, so you might as well watch this one.
Exactly. Yeah, it's certainly, you won't regret watching this one. I don't think so.
No.
Yeah. All right. So spoilers. Ready?
Let's go.
No, I guess Rosebud is just a piece in a jigsaw puzzle.
You want a cigarette? You got up here. I'll tell you all about it.
Things are going to start happening to me now.
And here we go.
All right, so real quickly before we get into other things, just the newscast element of how the people basically said you can't bomb on 4th of July, so they move it up to the July 3rd, I thought was actually a pretty fun, kind of elegant way of introducing that ticking time bomb, you know, because initially they're like, you'll get back with 24 hours to spare before the nuclear bomb even goes off, and then all of a sudden it's like an hour and a half away. And even for a movie I didn't, you know, I wasn't super into or super loving, I did go, oh no, how are they going to get out of this?
Well, see, you know, you always know that it's going to come down to the wire. You know, when they said, like, you have an extra day, you know, as an audience member, like, they're not going to have that extra day. Something's going to happen.
Right.
I thought, you know, maybe they would just get trapped in there and have to fight their way out and it would take a day longer than they thought.
Yeah.
But yeah, I agree with you. This was kind of like a, yeah, I guess elegance is a good word for it, right? Like, let the outside, you know, like the back and forth of politics make something like that unpredictable. I buy it. Sure.
Yeah. Exactly. You do know, but the way that it happens was a surprise and not what I was expecting. So it felt good.
I completely agree. If I can see like a plot mechanic coming, like, oh yeah, they need a ticking bomb device, because why not? Every zombie movie works, you know, every heist movie works better with a ticking clock. So if you can get us to that ticking clock in an unpredictable way, then have at it. Especially in a movie that's otherwise deemed with so many cliches that you do see coming, and then unfortunately it does not surprise you.
Yeah. And I guess we can get into some of those cliches.
Yeah, let me kick off one here. Sure. The guy in the group that just wants to go against the group because he has another plan going on.
Yeah.
But it's evil, and he has to bust out the right time to be really evil, right? This has very Predators vibes, right? With, like, remember Topher Grace and Predators?
Yes.
You know, like, every time you have a ragtag group of, like, hard asses, there's always got to be, like, one stupid character in there that has, like, going against the grain and has their own plan and will fuck over the rest of the group at the right time. It's like, that's a cliche that I understand is just like a ticking clock element. You know, it helps rack it up the tension, but I find it to be completely irritating and like counterproductive to survival.
Yeah. In a movie like this, where you have people dealing with both a zombie apocalyptic landscape and, you know, city, plus a really difficult casino heist with an impending nuclear bomb, it just feels like cliche overkill to have this character.
Well, especially because we know we're going to have to go chase the daughter down anyway, because they've already talked about, like, you got to stay by my side. You can't come.
Yeah.
Okay, you can come, but you can't leave my side. So you know she's going to fucking run off. So it's like, I was already waiting on that dumb cliche.
Yeah.
And then we get, you know, like the bad guy within the group.
Yeah. And then
like, I got my own plan going on. Wink.
Yeah, and it has to be the cliche that is really tired of, let's turn these into weapons for the military and make money off that, which is,
I don't even know how
many times.
It's like the Raptor thing from Jurassic World all over again.
Yeah, and it's just bad. And
I agree. And here's the thing. Remember like hard-ass blonde girl that's like tough as nails, and she's been in and out of the quarantine zone a million times?
Yeah, the coyote, I think they called her.
Yeah, the coyote, there we go. Why did she not immediately just rat that dude out whenever he cut off that zombie queen's head?
I got the impression that he promised her a bunch of money or some great reward. Okay. And
because that's part of our deal. I was thinking, like, why would she have any loyalty to this guy?
Yeah.
She's like the expert. She should know how bad of an idea this is.
Well, that's one of those moments that, or one of those character choices that I didn't understand. And one of the reasons I say, you know, we could use more of this movie to develop some things, because I don't understand what she was getting out of even helping them in the first place. You know, they were like, oh, she's helping people get in and get some money. I guess she got some money from it, but they never really explained that I recall. Or
maybe it was just the idea of like helping out people. Like, remember, because like they were going also in there, the daughter was to try to get someone out of there.
Yeah.
She looked for someone
and
too.
And she would help these people get in. They would steal money from, you know, I think they talked about busting open a slot machine, steal money, and then they could pay off a guard to let them out of like the prison quarantine city or whatever. So it kind of seemed like she would do it, you know, altruistically as a good Samaritan. But why is she also on this plan that is probably going to screw everybody over? And
yeah.
Take these zombies outside of the city into the world and potentially, you know, have it be used as a weapon or whatever. Like, it doesn't make sense to the character, and I don't understand it.
Yeah, like, I was thinking her character right away would have been like, well, now I gotta murder you, you know, and then like there would have been like a fight between them. But
yeah,
nope.
Yeah, she just kept going and then was surprised when he screwed him over and like locked the gate thing.
Yeah, although she did have the foresight to switch out the bags. But
she did.
That didn't really stop him from fucking them over in the first place. It just stopped him from getting what he wanted once he did.
Yeah. Yeah. And then, I mean, how satisfied were you with like that character's death? The guy with the tiger?
The tiger thing? Meh. You know, I mean, I wasn't not satisfied with it.
Yeah, it was.
You know, I mean, I don't know. I don't know what I could have wanted more other than maybe Dave Bautista killing him.
Yeah, I mean, I get it that they set up that he hates the tiger and he's super scared of it. So it's like the way for him to die that would be worse for his character. But
I feel like it's not any worse than a regular zombie attack, to be honest with you.
No, I don't think so. It's just that he had a specific grudge against that tiger for whatever reason.
Because if a zombie snake was killing me.
Yeah. But I think it would have been more satisfying to have someone take their revenge on him, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
But I don't know. We get a pretty gruesome death. I've never seen someone get killed by a zombie tiger by having their head crushed by its mouth.
But now you have.
Yeah, now I have. So, whatever.
Bucket list.
Yeah. So, I think one of the other cliched things, and I kept thinking maybe the film would skirt it, but I mean, I guess maybe it's a rule of zombie movies that really only one person can survive. But I just kept being bummed out when someone would finally have the thing where they would get bit. And I was like, I want some of these people to survive. I don't know. It just feels too by the numbers whenever people. Well, I guess the big one is Dave Bautista.
Yeah. I was kind of bummed out whenever he died. But also, I mean, it's a zombie movie. Most zombie movies worth their weight in salt. Not all, but most. The coolest characters die.
Yeah, that's true. Was he the coolest character?
I don't know. I mean, I like Dave Bautista in this movie. I like him more than I liked anyone else.
Yeah.
I like the guy that ended up living, quote, at the end, and like started going to Mexico only to find out that he was bit too.
Yeah.
I liked that guy.
I think that was another one, just because that's a thing of... Oh, we got to reveal someone's bit.
Yep.
And that was kind of disappointing to me.
Yeah, I agree. It was a little disappointing. I think he was trying to emulate the Dawn of the Dead ending where like, oh, they get to the island, but once they get there, they're hosed, you know?
Yeah.
I think it's, you know, try to kick you off like, oh man, Army of the Dead 2 in Mexico City, you know?
Yeah. And I guess we can talk about, this isn't really on the cliche line, but did you have any more cliche sort of things that you wanted to go over?
Not really anything that's worth it.
I did feel that even though they did some interesting things with the sort of evolved zombies, the alpha zombies.
Yeah.
I don't know, something felt like weirdly cliched or kind of lame about what they were doing. And
yeah,
so, I don't know.
I think the alphas kind of looked lame. They always looked like a bunch of Tommy Wiseaus.
Yeah, okay.
You know what I mean? From like The Room?
Yeah, yeah.
Like they were long hair and like weird muscles. It's like, I don't know. Like they just look kind of dumb, I thought.
Mm-hmm.
Like I think the zombies in this are really lacking. Like in Dawn of the Dead, they were like bloody and they were gory and they were like regular people. These seem like they're mutated people. Like it seems like they're not really zombies. Like they're more conscious than zombies. They all have the same complexion, right? Like they're not just like people with like rotting skin. Instead, like their skin has become whatever these zombies are now. It's like thicker and
yeah.
It's like it's a little different than your regular zombie, and I don't know that I like it better. Although I do like the idea that they can do something besides just regular zombie things, because that adds like an element of danger.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know if it was fleshed out enough for me to be satisfied with it.
No, I don't think so. I think part of the look with the zombie thing, too, is that, you know, they were in Vegas and in the desert, essentially, with a lot of sun. So, you know, Dawn of the Dead is the beginning. So a lot of the zombies are pretty fresh and bloody. Yeah. And this one,
that's true. Vegas has been walled off for a while now in this movie.
Yeah. I think that was another thing that confused me, was how much time had passed between that starting and then the main events of the movie, you know,
I assumed a couple years.
Well, at some point they say a few years, and that's kind of what they gathered after a while. But you know,
cause like Dave Bautista's like, moved away and has another job, and everyone's like, you know, everyone we saw in the beginning has like moved on with their lives, you know.
Yeah, it took me a while to understand that, and I think even at the point where him and his daughter are having it out, and she's like, "You were never around," and I was like, "How long has it been?" Because it doesn't seem like that long. And but point being, you know, the dried out zombies, I think, give them a different look
than maybe what I expected. Bunch of raisins.
Yeah. And also they set up a thing that I found super interesting whenever they first go into the city, and there's all the dried out zombies piled around. Uh-huh. There's like thousands and thousands of them. And the coyote character says, "You should see what happens when it rains."
Oh, interesting.
And I was like, she was like, "They all come back to life for a while." And I was like, "All right, it's going to rain at some point." And all these things
that would have been nuts. That'd have been cool.
Wake up. I know. I got really hyped on that idea. And but I was pretty disappointed when it never came to be.
Yeah. That would have been a better third act.
Yeah, that's what I expected the third act to
be. Them, like, have the helicopter not work, have them have to walk back, and right at the home stretch, they're like, "Fuck yeah, we're almost out of here with our money. Nothing bad happened, you know?" And then all of a sudden, it's just like rain, and then they have to like separate and scatter. And like the last 20 minutes is just them trying to, you know.
Yeah.
That'd have been cool.
Yeah, it would have been cool. And I think it would have been fun.
Here's one thing that really, before we part ways here, here's one thing that I think really, like, I think this is the most egregious error in the movie. Of all the nitpicks and all the cliches and all this stuff, this isn't even a cliche. This is just something that I think is bad about the movie. Okay, so the daughter, you know, pretty much risks everyone's life, gets a lot of people killed to go save her friend, right?
Yeah.
And then they get in the helicopter with Tig Notaro as the pilot, you know, and she was funny.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she dies. Dave Bautista dies. I guess the daughter's friend dies, but we don't really get a close-up or any conversation or acknowledgement about it.
Yeah, she's just suddenly the only one left, so I just had to make an assumption there.
Exactly, but it's like, I don't know, if she was important enough for you to like risk everyone dying to go get, maybe look for her first.
Yeah, look for her as well as
like
your dad.
Show us a close-up of her dead and then be like, oh, the futility of that whole adventure.
Yeah, I think we need that to drive that point home a little bit better, is to show...
I honestly think the end is kind of a mess and doesn't work at all because of that. I was kind of in a bad mood when Dave Bautista started dying. Because I was like, I'm pretty sure that woman's dead, but unless they show me walking away at the end with her, I'll be really upset. And they didn't, so...
Yeah, I'm with you. I had the exact same thought. That whole last scene was, what about your friend that you risked life and limb
for? Yeah, it was like a lot... The logic of it all undercut the emotion. You're right? Like, show her dead before we go over there and see Dave Bautista bit.
Yeah, and that's another example of the thing where I felt like more movie to flesh things out could have been better. It could have been worse. You know, I don't know.
Yeah.
Because it is a long movie already. Relatively speaking,
Zack Snyder loves his slow motion.
Yeah.
Oh, dude, it was cool though. I will admit, it was cool when Dave Bautista got up on the table and he's like running from table to table, shooting his machine gun.
Mm-hmm.
That was super rad.
Yeah, the action sort of sequences were really good, I think, and that's where he, I think, shines with the zombie movie.
Yeah, I think that's what he was excited to get to.
Yeah. So that was a lot of fun. I liked the guy who was really good at killing zombies. That would, he would do it on like TikTok or Instagram or whatever.
that
character was really fun. That was in it almost for the glory. And one of the things I did like was in the recruiting the army sort of segment.
Yeah.
I like that everyone
kept getting paid less and less. Like the less he liked you.
Yeah, yeah. Everyone they kept going to, they just offered less money to than the person before.
But each time, these people are like, $20,000? Heck yeah, I'll do it.
Yeah. I think the first person was, you can have $2 million.
I'm glad they lowballed them.
Yeah. They started low and everyone just took it. No one even negotiated, I don't think, ever.
Yeah. Did you notice while watching it that Tig Notaro, the pilot, she was actually replaced another actor and she was digitally inserted later, so she wasn't even like in any scenes with anyone else?
I did not notice. I knew the story going in. So I watched for it and I couldn't see the seams.
Like there's a lot of really shallow depth of field around her, like shallow focus all around her to keep the backgrounds blurry, which I'm sure is the reason why. But like I said earlier, Zack Snyder is so skilled at working with like visual effects artists and with green screen and just like, you know what I mean? Like he can just make that kind of stuff look good. He's really good at that kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah. definitely good at pulling that sort of stuff off. But with the shallow depth of field, that was actually an intentional choice. I saw that and read that he went onto like eBay and bought these old lenses that he really liked.
Interesting.
And paired them with a camera. I can't remember the names of the lenses or the cameras off the top of my head, but...
Like, well, I know he was his own DP on this film.
Yeah, he was. And he was like obsessed with these lenses. And then when combining them with this camera, with like the sensor type on the camera, it gives an extremely shallow depth of field, which is what he wanted. So I think that was just baked into the movie and not part of...
Okay. Well, I mean, I don't... that's not a choice that bothers me, per se. But I thought that was like a technical reason why. You know, I thought like, Tig, he's trying to cover the seams here.
Yeah. Surprisingly, no. That's what he wanted, like the super shallow depth of field. I think the thing I was watching, he said something like, it's such a harsh landscape and it's so depressing and apocalyptic. Like, I want it to be kind of soft and beautiful in a way.
Okay.
Just to kind of contrast with the mood.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah.
What'd you think of the font choice?
It was a nice color, but an interesting font.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, man. I had one other...
tapped out.
I had one other thing that I was just about to talk about, and...
Let's do it.
I don't know that it's in my head anymore. I will say, maybe this is it, maybe not. I can't remember now, but I did enjoy some of the fun they had with the zombies, like having them go test the things for the casino. Like the... Or not casino, the vault.
Like the booby traps?
Yeah, that's the booby traps. Yeah, yeah. That was pretty fun. And you got a really silly zombie kill out of it. The thing being like smashed between walls.
Yeah.
It was fun.
It was really silly, but it was fun. I also, it was like a very Raiders of the Lost Ark moment. I also would be mad if I were them that like the dude who hired us and was like, be sure you trip all the booby traps first. But like, dude, why don't you tell us exactly how many booby traps there were?
Yeah. Yeah, I know. And he said they were non-lethal. Yeah. Why not just tell him they're lethal so they'd be extra careful?
Yeah, it's like you're sending them there to get your money, dude.
Yeah. And it's all... I don't know if it tries to explain some of that away, because they try to play it up like he doesn't care about the money. All he wants is this zombie's head. And it's like, well, the first person you encounter when you walk into the city is that zombie's head. So why didn't you just go in and get that? And why have this dumb big heist?
Yeah. Why didn't the dude from No Country for Old Men and Deadwood just immediately be like, oh, I got what I came for. Yeah.
There she is. And I guess he's got to do it so they don't know, but why the whole elaborate plan to get in there when, you know, if you had talked to the coyote, who apparently somehow, again, this is one of those things I don't understand, how she had such great communication and rules with these alpha zombies to like understand them. I don't get it, but it seems like she could have said, if that's all you want, we can walk right in here and cut off the zombie's head. We don't have to risk 10 other people's lives and on some heist that you supposedly don't care about the money.
Yeah.
I don't know. What?
Yeah.
What were like, because I text you while watching the film at a certain point when I had paused it to go take a restroom break. And I was like, this movie confuses me. And you said something to the effect of, there were some things that I really like about it. And I don't know if we've covered all of those.
Well, I mean, the action.
Okay.
Right? The action. I think most of the performances are pretty funny, charming, good.
Yeah.
Not all of them, but most of them.
Yeah. Actually, I think Ella Purnell, his daughter, is really good.
She is really
good. I think she's the best performance-wise.
She has the most acting to do.
She does. Maybe that's it.
Everyone else is just a tough guy.
Yeah, she doesn't have a tough guy character, like a over the top sort of caricature to play.
Right. Yeah, I don't know. I liked the plot. I liked the walling off a city. You know, it was a different approach to the zombie outbreak. I enjoyed that.
Yeah. Okay.
So I don't know. I mean, nothing that I liked. I think I've mentioned it all throughout the episode.
Yeah, okay.
It's just I don't think it compared to how much I didn't like.
I just wanted to give you the chance because I do feel like we probably spent more time dogging the movie than not.
Yeah, we have, but I mean, I don't know. I was pretty upfront with my 2.5 stars. Like,
yeah.
It's a good sit. I still think that, like, even if you're listening to this movie or this review and you're like, damn, these guys really hated this movie, I'm not going to watch it. I wouldn't recommend that. It's on Netflix.
Yeah. How hard is it to watch? Not very.
Yeah. It's still fun. You'll have fun with it. Probably.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah. Speaking of fun, I think maybe my favorite moment in the whole film in terms of just general zombie action was in the opening credits. There's the military member that's parachuting down, and he just slowly parachutes.
Oh God, yeah.
Into the crowd of zombies.
I laughed at that a lot.
Yeah, I was like, oh, that poor guy.
I was like, oh man, that sucks. He's just like shooting like one or two guys, and he's just like, oh man.
He's just like slowly descending via parachute into the crowd and like inevitable death.
Yeah, yeah. That sucks.
Yeah, that was terrible.
He should have shot himself.
I thought he was going to, and
maybe he didn't have time. I don't know. But yeah, I laughed a lot at that in the opening credits. I think you said it earlier. Zack Snyder is just. I'll say this actually right here. Adding now, not only is he good at opening credits, he's good with music. I think.
Oh yeah, yeah. I think like, so. I think
he's got this energy and this like this kinetic energy with music. Sometimes when music is used in movies, it's lame. And it falls flat, right?
Yeah.
I don't ever feel that with Zack Snyder's. You know, even in movies I don't like, I think he uses pop songs really well.
Yeah.
With the exception of maybe using Hallelujah during the Justice League trailer, which I thought was a stupid idea.
Yeah.
But apparently Hallelujah by Leonard Cohen was his daughter who killed herself. That was like her favorite song. So.
Oh, okay.
Apparently it's sentimental to him.
Yeah.
So I understand the urge to want to use it.
I'll forgive him, and he already nailed using that song once in Watchmen.
That's true.
So,
but yeah, I think, you know, music is really where he shines. Like, I think opening, like, montages and action sequences and music, like, the man would probably, and probably has, directed many music videos.
Yeah.
And would be good at it.
Yeah, I think so. I really like the Suspicious Minds use early on mm-hmm. in the... Another Richard Cheese song, which is a bit of a callback to Dawn of the Dead.
Don't fix what ain't broke.
Yeah, he had the Richard Cheese cover of Disturbed's Down with the Sickness in Dawn of the Dead. And then this one, it was a cover of Viva Las Vegas over the opening credits.
I like that cover of Viva Las Vegas, too.
Yeah, yeah, I like that. I will complain slightly, and it's not necessarily his fault, but there are maybe one too many... I don't know what you call this genre, but moody covers of pop songs or classic rock or pop songs.
Yeah.
Which is a big thing in movie trailers that and TV trailers and different and commercials that I'm kind of sick of.
Me too.
And there was one in this that really rubbed me the wrong way. I think maybe it was a moody cover of This Is the End by the Doors.
Oh yeah, that there was a weird cover of This Is the End in there.
Yeah, I can't remember if that's the one that rubbed me the wrong way, or if there was one that rubbed me even more wrong, but there were a couple of them that I was just like, great, moody.
Actually, moody I think it's cover. Called just The End, isn't it?
It is called The End. I realized that as I said it, and then I just rolled with it.
Yeah,
you're right.
I think people would probably know what you're talking about.
Yeah. Cool. This Is the End is the name of the other apocalyptic movie that's we don't speak about.
Yeah.
At least I don't.
Because it's bad.
Yeah, you said it, not me.
It is bad.
Yeah. Cool. Well,
I stand by that.
Yeah. On that note, since we're talking about other movies, are we done with Army of the Dead?
I think so. I thought I was tapped out a minute ago. You got a little bit more out of me, but I am officially tapped out now.
Yeah. Same. So that does it for this episode then. Nothing else to do.
Yeah. All right. Well. Thanks for listening, everyone.
Yeah, thanks for listening. Mike, thanks for talking Army of the Dead with me. As always, thank you, Jake Wagner-Russell, for doing our intro and outro music. If you want to hear more of his music, you can do so at soundcloud.com/bobs.